Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today we are going to discuss for the date 2nd August 2018. Today we are going to see 5 topics in our discussion. Today's first topic is prudent increase. RBI's Monetary Policy Committee have raised interest rates by 25 basis points again. Why they have increased? Because there is uncertainty in inflation front. There is a continuous volatility in crude oil prices. It led to geopolitical tensions. It also led to supply disruptions. So there is an uncertainty in inflation front. That's why RBI has increased its policy rate. What are the other concerns of RBI? There is already global financial market is in volatile situation. And recently, government has increased MSP for kharif crops. It may lead to inflation. And there is a possibilities of fiscal slippage at the central level as well as at the state level, and there is an impact of upward revision for house rent allowances by the state government, which will also lead to inflation. There is a rainfall deficiency over wide area by 6% compared to last year. Reduction in sown area will lead to less production. This less production cannot meet the demands of the people. This obviously will lead to inflation. All over the world, trade protectionism is gaining ground. It leads to investment flow disruption, and also it disrupts the global supply chain. It also leads to hurting of all-round productivity. There is a depreciation in the value of most currencies that belong to emerging economy against the dollar. It will also lead to inflation. Inflation is widely accepted as a hidden tax on the poor, so it has to be contained. To contain inflation, MPC, that is Monetary Policy Committee, has taken this decision of increasing the repo rate. Let's see something about Monetary Policy Committee and its mandate. This Monetary Policy Committee was created in 2016 to enhance the transparency and accountability in fixing this monetary policy. This Monetary Policy Committee is 6 members committee. It is headed by RBI chairman. He is ex officio chairman of this particular committee. 3 members from RBI, 3 members will be nominated by government. All the decisions will be taken by the majority vote. This RBI governor, who is ex officio chairman of this Monetary Policy Committee, will be having a casting vote. It is the responsibility of the Monetary Policy Committee to keep the inflation between 2% to 6%. That is, the lower tolerance is 2%, the upper tolerance is 6% of inflation. Let's see something about repo rate and reverse repo rate. Repo rate is the rate at which RBI lends money to the commercial banks. Similarly, reverse repo rate is the rate at which RBI borrows money from commercial banks. Today's second topic is unemployment to stay. Recently, International Labour Organization released World Employment and Social Outlook Report for 2018. It says that India's unemployment rate would be staying at 3.5%. Whereas China's unemployment rate is going to increase from 4.6% to 4.7%. The worrying fact is that India's 77% of employment comes under vulnerable employment category. Who are coming under vulnerable employment? Those who are self-employed and those who are working in family establishment are considered to be vulnerable employed. Why they are called vulnerable employees? Because they lack decent working conditions. They lack social security. That's why they are called vulnerably employed. This report also says that India's growth rate is going to be at 7.4% in 2018 against 6.7% in 2017. Informality is the one thing that affects India's employment by 90%. Not only agriculture sector, even other sectors also comes under informality. Why there is informality by 90%? There is a labor market rigidities. Because of this rigidity, manufacturers are not coming forward to create employment. So the government has to come forward to ensure that all the people are working in a proper working conditions and they are having enough social security and they are having a proper employment. Today's third topic is reconsider the ban on oxytocin. Recently, Union Health Ministry banned on the retail sale and private manufacture of oxytocin. What is this oxytocin? Which is synthetic version of human hormone. It is a lifesaver drug of women. Doctors use this oxytocin to induce labor in pregnant women to stem postpartum bleeding. This is very critical in maternal health. That is why World Health Organization also recommends this drug for the postpartum hemorrhage. But why government has decided to ban this? Because there is a widespread misuse of this drug in dairy sector. Why dairy sector using this oxytocin? Because it stimulates lactation in cattle. So the farmers are using this drug indiscriminately to enhance the production. So the government has to do something about it, because farmers are using this particular drug indiscriminately. That will lead to lot of chaos. So several unlicensed facilities that manufacturing this particular drug for veterinary use have to be contained. So government is trying to ban this drug in order to avoid this indiscriminatory usage. On the one side, this drug is very much useful to the women. On the other side, indiscriminate usage is happening. So what would be the right approach? The right approach would have been to strengthen the regulation and crack down on the illegal production of oxytocin. There is a belief that oxytocin has its own ill effects like infertility in the dairy animals, but it is not based on the scientific evidence. In 2015, National Dairy Research Institute said there was no proper evidence, scientific evidence, to prove that oxytocin lead to infertility. Government's decision to ban this particular oxytocin drug is not acceptable because 45,000 women die due to causes related to childbirth each year. So this oxytocin is needed to prevent this. You are all aware of the fact that antibiotics is used indiscriminately by the people, but government is not going to ban this. Why? Because in India, especially in rural India, more people still die due to lack of antibiotics than the usage of antibiotics. In this oxytocin case, government decides that PSU, that is only one PSU, will manufacture this drug. This will lead to drug shortages. In turn, it will increase the price. Today's fourth topic is scaled up solutions for the future water scarcity. Precious evolutionary living sources and natural infrastructure are going extinct. What it means? We have two types of infrastructure. They are namely artificial infrastructure, natural infrastructure. What is natural infrastructure? Like forest, rivers, mountains, aquifers and soils are all natural infrastructure. Artificial infrastructure, like we build dam, road, port, you know, to make our life sophisticated, we build a lot of artificial infrastructure. That is fine. Building artificial infrastructure itself is not wrong, but at the cost of what is the question? Natural infrastructures like forest, rivers, mountains, aquifers, soils are all being lost at an alarming rate. We cannot engineer these infrastructure, so we have to conserve this. So let's come to the topic, that is, let's come to the main theme of this topic. Today, India is in the midst of societal water crisis. What we have to do? Water crisis is being heard in everywhere. You might have heard about South African water crisis and Bangalore water crisis. Activists, scientists and experts from across India working on bottom-up schemes to revive and rejuvenate lakes, streams and wetlands and other small water bodies. Since population is growing exponentially, our cities continue to spread. High densities of our cities do not allow for water harvesting to fill the gap. One side, large cities are growing, and other side, agriculture needs more water. To meet these, invasive schemes like dams are being built. That's not a problem, but ultimately, this end up in ecological devastation. Nature is the source from which we get products and services. That's fine, but we can't afford to destroy the source itself. In the era of global free market, the level of human intervention is more than the level of or the scale of the planet. Gandhi once said, nature has enough to provide, or nature has enough to meet the demands of humans, but not the greed. Natural resources are often lost to the greed of governments, institutions, corporations, and of course, we individuals. Natural resources are constantly renewed by natural cycles, so therefore they provide us perennial value as long as we use them with natural wisdom and do not kill them with exploitation. See this image. Floodplain is located, no? Floodplain is an area of low-lying ground adjacent to river, mainly formed by river sediments, and it is subject to flooding. Floodplains of rivers are exceptional aquifers, that is, these area are considered to be exceptional aquifers. Some floodplains that belong to Himalayan rivers contain up to 20 times more water than the virgin flow of rivers in a year. Since recharge in the floodplain is taking place during rain and late flood, the water quality is very good. If we conserve and use floodplain properly, it can remain as a self-sustaining aquifer. This article has given one example. This is Delhi Pala floodplain project. Have a look on this. Land on the floodplains that belong to farmers can be taken for lease. From that land, water can be taken and used for cities. Government can provide profitable income to the farmers. The farmers can also be encouraged to grow orchards, food forests to secure and restore ecological balance and the river ecosystem. Mineral water has become a part and parcel of our day-to-day life. This is brought from faraway mountain springs. It puts extra pressure on the mountains. And we use plastic bottles that ended up in filling landfills. But when it comes to forested hills, they are result of evolution over millions of years. They are not polluted because they sit on the treasure of underground aquifers. This is because rainfalls on the forest area seeps through various layers of humus and cracked rock pathways. It picking up nutrients and minerals, it flows to the underground and settles there as mineral water aquifers. When it comes to quality, it can be compared to several international natural spring mineral waters. We have to adopt conserve and use policy in order to use water sustainably. Today's fifth topic is NRC. To what end this exercise? We will discuss in this topic, which we have not discussed earlier, our NRC article. We all know that Supreme Court is monitoring the entire process of National Register of Citizens for Assam. So one would have hoped that since Supreme Court is monitoring, the entire process will have a fairness and transparency. From the non-transparent family tree verification process to the arbitrary rejection of Gram Panchayat certificates, the entire process is riddled with legal inconsistencies and errors. To cite an example, some of the parents' names are in the list, but their children's names are left out. In February 2017, in Manohara Bewa vs. Union of India case, the Guwahati High Court declared that certificates issued by Gram Panchayats cannot be relied on by residents to seek inclusion in the NRC. This particular judgment had a wide ranging of impact on the NRC preparation. Many people submitted Gram Panchayat certificates in order to defend their citizenship, but it was rejected. It was only last December Supreme Court clarified that Panchayat certificates can be relied upon provided the documents themselves had been appropriately proved in the court. Still, the fates of lakhs of people, that is excluded 40 lakhs people, relying on these documents remain uncertain. Supreme Court has provided deadline before which entire NRC process has to be completed. This author is questioning whether the deadline is important or legal clarity over the manner in which the citizenship is decided should be important. The author is questioning what would be the fate of the excluded people from the list. Who will protect the basic rights of those who have been rendered stateless and defenseless? Vallabhbhai Patel said, India's constitution-making process, especially its citizenship clause, was going to be scrutinized all over the world. Again, this is going to be scrutinized when this NRC process gets over. The Indian subcontinent has seen multiple large-scale humanitarian crises erupt over question of nationhood, citizenship and identity. Let's wait and watch how our government is dealing with the issue.